Hello, guys and girls, and welcome to episode 38 of the VR Inside podcast. This is a weekly VR, AR, and MR talk show that is live streamed every Saturday on Nathie's YouTube channel. You can tune into the show live at the new times of 7 p.m. in Europe, 6 p.m. in the UK, and 12 midday in central US. If you miss the live show, you can catch up with the whole show as I re-upload it every Sunday to my own YouTube channel, Virtual Reality Oasis. Or check out the audio-only version, which is available on Google Play Music, iTunes, and on SoundCloud. If you enjoy the audio version, please leave us a review, because that would really help us out. If you've got any questions, comments, or feedback during the show, please put them in the chat, and we'll try to answer as many questions as we can. So if you're new to the show and you've never seen an episode of this show before, let me introduce you to the team. First up, this guy loves to see the sparks fly by playing with fireworks in virtual reality. And I'm not talking about M80s. No. I'm talking about M Nathies. Oh, yes, of course. It is Nathie. How you doing, dude? You all right?
Yes, I'm juggling with grenades in my spare time. And
one more word joke.
I don't know any other Nathie words here, but
what about Nathie? What about Nathie Potato? That was a classic, right?
Illuminati confirmed. That's also one. Yeah. No, but I'm doing alrighty tighty. Yes, thank you for asking.
Good to hear it. So next up, this guy wants you to be his goose to his maverick when he takes to the skies in virtual reality, and is of course our resident rowdy guy. How you doing, dude? You all right?
I'm all right, dude. I'm actually doing great. I'm not in my usual spot, as you can see. I'm actually in my parents' place today. So change the location, change the scene. But
you're at the summer mansion.
Yeah, the summer mansion. My summer mansion. Yeah. I wish.
And next up, if you're wondering how Zim hurt his back, well, it's a little known fact about Zim that he's actually Tom Green's stunt double. How you doing, dude? You all right? How's your back nowadays?
Yeah, I keep putting my bum on a fence and then on the lawn. No, things are okay there. So, I can't say improving yet, but I'm working on it. So, but everything else is good. You know, life is good in general. And there's, I'm enjoying my Go. I'm enjoying my Rift. Just having fun with a bunch of kind of simple titles at the moment. So,
yeah, it's a great time to be in VR. That is for sure. Yeah. That is for sure. So last, but by no means least, myself, Mike, the host of the show from Virtual Reality Oasis. In today's episode, we're going to be talking about Rec Room Royale. Are you hungry for some chicken dinners in virtual reality? We're a forest. Will this update to the forest make it the VR survival crafting game we've all been looking for? Well, stay tuned to find. And finally, we're going to be talking about the Vive Focus updates. HTC are adding 6 degrees of freedom controller support, hand tracking, and streaming of desktop VR games. So all this information will be coming up later on in the show. But we're going to start this week's show like we always do nowadays, and that is to find out what everyone has been playing this week. So let's find out what Nathie has been up to first.
Okay. Well, before I start talking about my game, I'm sorry for the twitching in my webcam. I'm getting jammed by aliens at the moment, and I can't do much about it. No, it's my motherboard. It's usually like a little, But anyways, happens. But I played a lot of games. I played some stuff on the Oculus Go. I played some stuff on the Oculus Rift. So I went from mobile to PC, and I decided to play Toy Box with you, Mike, because that was on my list for a while now. And as you may know, Toy Box launched together with the Oculus Touch, as far as I know. It's basically a co-op experience demo thing, and where you can just play with toys together. So you have a table, and Mike is on one side of the table, I'm on the other side, and we can play with the physics, we can just mess around. There's no goal in this game. You can just destroy things, you can build towers, you can... But physics-wise, it's a very impressive title, and lots of those physics in Toy Box are not even in the games you see now.
That's true.
It's the same with First Contact. I did a demo this week to someone showing First Contact, and I was like, how many games have you played where you can flick things for a puzzle, or where you need to really push buttons in a way that First Contact does.
Yeah.
It's very rare. So I'm like, have the developers never learned from these experiences? Because they are not only there to show people the potential of VR, but it also gives developers the opportunity to start off as well. So I'm not sure what you guys think about this, but that's something I noticed.
Yeah, I think a lot has to do with that as well, with like, since a lot of people like develop also for the HTC Vive, and then you don't have the finger tracking, and then with Oculus you do have it, but then, you know, you don't want to separate that market and like just only HTC and just only Oculus. So I think it's safer for a lot of developers just not to include that kind of stuff. Well, First Contact, of course, is an Oculus experience.
That's exactly what Monkey was saying.
Yeah,
for a long time. He was saying that basically all the, you know, you're going to have your control mechanisms out there, and there's going to be a center point where just developers kind of hone in on what's common across these platforms. And unfortunately, it's hard to get away from that, to what you said, Rowdy.
Maybe when the Knuckles comes out and that's got finger tracking on it, maybe that some of those things will correlate over, and maybe more developers will implement them.
I've even noticed it with like Oculus exclusives, where you also don't really see that happen that much. There are titles where they nail it, like Lone Echo, for example, but there are enough where it's like, why can I not press this button? I'm not going to talk too much about Red Matter because I'm sure someone else wants to talk about that. But when I was playing that game, there were moments where I could go to like a control panel, and I was trying to push the buttons, but I couldn't do it. There was nothing, like my hand was just going through the wall. So after playing First Contact, my expectations got a little higher again for what the standard should be. You know, like you're expecting buttons to work. You expect cans to just flip when you touch them that way. You know, so I still think that the touch controllers can be used so much better in many games.
So it's funny because obviously I jumped into Toybox with you, and one of the funny things was, like you say, we were really playing around with the physics of the game. And at one point we had a load of M-Nathies all piled up, which are M-80s, piled up with these sort of fuses all pointed together. And then we had a lighter which was on fire. And then we used other lighters stacked up like dominoes, like on a little trail. And then we used a remote control tank to kick off the domino sort of effect, and that sort of tripled them up and fired off. It was really, really fun, you know, messing around with all the physics mechanics and those things together.
It's showing off the power of, like, you know, social interaction. That's what it is. Yeah. And this is one of those great examples where you can just step into together with your friends and really feel like you're there together messing around.
Although what you really don't want to experience is when you look under a virtual desk and there is a little Nathie Smeagol hiding underneath there calling out your name. That's just terrifying. Yeah.
Oh my God. I have to call this out from chat. Someone said, so I don't really understand spoken English. Are these four guys discussing four stages of growing a beard?
Yeah, that's
what it looks like.
Right here, like,
yeah. That's a funny one. Yeah, I'm the one that never grows a beard. Just saying, but
I'm the one who forgets to shave.
That's his excuse.
We should really put it in like a certain order, so it makes sense. Yeah.
So Zim, what have you been playing this week? And just for clarification, last week you mentioned a game, Vulcan, right?
Yep.
And it was like a kind of a game for the Oculus Go that sounded really interesting. But like, I went to try and find it. I couldn't find it. And we had a little chat just before the show. And the game is pronounced Vulcan as in V-O-L-C-A-N. Is that right?
I just put it in chat. So V-O-L-K-A-N is how you spell it.
Right.
So if you're
looking
for it, even if you searched for Vol as in volume, I think you'd find it. And the game, it's on Oculus Go. I gave it a big thumbs up because it's the kind of game that, I think it's got a fair amount of replayability. You'd probably only do 20 minutes in a session, but it was basically, it's Pathfinder. So you're having to move with your head, and then it's a platformer. And it's roguelike, so you try to keep going as long as you can.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So,
cool.
Thanks,
I'll check that out.
Hopefully, people will be able to find it now.
Yeah. Yeah. So, what else have you been up to this week, then, dude?
So, again, I'll end up on the Go again because my favorite surprise title of the week was definitely on Go. A game that I'll leave that for last. So, the games I've played this week, we have a fortnightly race publicly on Sunday with Assetto Corsa, so that was good fun as always. We played The Forest, which is one of those titles that I've been waiting for donkey's years to play. I mean, it was literally 2014, if I remember, when they first advertised it. And it was like, oh, right. And it was supposed to come out then with VR support. And then we kind of learned that that wasn't going to happen. So I just held off buying it. So I did 3 hours in that this week. And then Red Matter, again, did 3 hours in that. And the game that I wanted to mention in terms of the Go is a game title that if you're an American, you will have seen on game shelves over the last 20 years. It's a real classic, and I literally have never played one because it's for rednecks. It's Deer Hunter on the Go. I have to say that the rifle model, the guns that they've got in the game, the way the thing works, the way you pull up the sight and scope and go for like a lung shot or a heart shot with a particular animal, actually makes you feel kind of like a hunter. Like, it's relatively simple, but they've done it really well, and you just upgrade and then you get better guns and better accessories for your guns, and then it just like keeps going. But the modeling in it was a lot better than I was expecting. I was expecting it to be a kind of a trashy game, but I really liked
it. So can you just walk around in that game? Because usually Deer Hunter is pretty about like exploring the wild and try to find.
Is that true though? Because I'm from my familiarity with Deer Hunter, you're generally in a scene. There was a game, but it's not Deer Hunter, which came out, which was basically free roam in a forest and it was like more of a hunter sim. I think Deer Hunter has for the most part been kind of like Oregon Trail, where the hunting mode in Oregon Trail was you stay in place, things happen, and you're trying to kind of track down and shoot them. So it's more you're in one spot.
Oh.
You can use your head left or right like this to kind of move like WASD, you know, left and right strafing. But beyond that, you're in one scene and there's animals around. So what you're really trying to do is there's an objective that you're given, like kill two baby deer. And then, you know, with enough pints of ale in you, you feel like, okay, finally I can take the souls of these baby deer. And then you blast one, and of course the others start to scatter. And before they get off the scene, you got to blast them too. So that's really the premise of the game.
But what if I don't want to do that?
Well, then there's a bunch of
the game's gentler. Not for vegans.
It's not for vegans. Yeah. There's no tofu shots in this.
Yeah, it's funny you mentioned like a game like a hunting game, because I got into playing bait on the Oculus Go. I've never been fishing in my life, and I've never really been interested in fishing, but I was playing the Go for a long time, testing the battery out, and I just happened to find it. I think Rowdy said that his dad was playing it, so I was like, I'll check this out.
Played it for like maybe 4 or 6 hours straight.
Whoa!
Same here, like I ended up playing it like for about 2.5-3 hours straight, because this just got so sucked into it.
It's so satisfying then.
My dad loves fishing.
it's got this weird Zen type thing about it, where you're just very relaxed. You just cast in your little rod, waiting for a fish to come, and then sort of like pulling it in, collecting all the fish, and then you've got this kind of story and this like nice reward loop. So it's interesting that you mentioned the game that's very similar, that sounds kind of boring, but it actually turns out to be a lot of fun.
I played Bait about 2 weeks ago. It was one of the first things I played on the device, and I think Bait is... I played it until my Oculus Go overheated, because I was charging and playing at the same time, and I think that was about 3.5 hours or so, and then I had to shut it down. But as you say, like the animations are great. So the different fish look wildly different, and they don't just stay on like these are fish in the world and that's all you can catch. Like they make up fish, so it's actually quite exciting. Yeah. It's a bit closer to remember that PS4 game which I mentioned, which was Masters of the Deep, which was a Final Fantasy game. It's kind of like that actually, bit like that, and quite good.
My dad went like two full charges on that game. Like just I had to recharge it completely, and then he went back in and just played it. He didn't do anything because he didn't care about the story. He just wanted to do the fishing. And by the end, he had like I think like $56,000 worth of fish. Like
that's hilarious. That's
hilarious, yeah.
So what about you then, Rowdy? What have you been playing this week?
I've been playing a little bit of Red Matter, but I'll leave that one to you. And then I actually played a few Oculus Go titles again. Like I played once this time on the Oculus Go to try out how it worked there, which actually works fairly smooth. Which is one of those games that also doesn't really need the 6 degrees of tracking, so that's a big advantage. I've played how is it called? American.
American Dream.
I've played in that one, and then the one indeed that I wanted to mention was Overflight, which I played in the Oculus Go, which is a flight simulator. But it's I have a funny history with flight simulators. Like I played VTOL. I don't know if any of you guys ever played that one on the Vive, which is a really good flight simulator. I mean, it's really accurate, but it's so accurate that I literally can't like fly the plane.
VTOL,
VTOL, vertical takeoff
and landing.
Yeah. Oh, what is the O stand for?
Off vertical.
Take off landing. Yeah. Okay. And because I know that Viper did a video on that, and I saw that video. I was like, oh man, that looks so cool. I want to try that too. And I tried it, and like literally, like on the vertical takeoff, my plane already crashed. Like that was hilarious. But overflight is actually much more. Because there's not that many buttons, you know, you don't have the 6 degrees of tracking, so there's like much more limitation kinds of flying. But there is a storyline in there, which makes it kind of interesting. I always like that when a game, even if it's a simple storyline, you know, I still think it's better than none. I'm not saying that the storyline is that good, but it does make it more interesting to play it. And they have this like kind of nice narration that goes through it. The graphics are not all that great, but I mean, for a mobile game, it's actually very, very impressive. I really like that one.
So how do you like fly a plane with a gyro controller?
Gyroscope.
Oh, okay.
Right. And you've got like buttons that you have to interact with and like levers and stuff.
But it's like the things that you need to do is like, you know, increase the speed. Like that is a handle you can like pull forward and backward. You can open a door if like a crate needs to go out. And then, of course, you have triggers for like shooting, which is kind of hard to do. I didn't know, like, you know, like if you see like in the movies, like, you know, like Maverick and Goose, like you see him shooting and whatever. You know, that works like perfectly. But I really had to, because, you know, when the plane is that way, you need to calculate like where the plane is going to be by the time that your bullets hit, which makes it a lot harder to like shoot things. Yeah.
Cool. Yeah. Cool. No, it sounds like a lot of fun. Yeah. But yeah, like you say, I played Red and like first off, I know we've mentioned it a couple of times on the podcast just recently, but like first off, like the game graphically is like so gorgeous. Like I think the visuals are kind of like on par with sort of Lone Echo standards in my mind, like some of the best graphics on so far. I also like the fact that it's a story-driven campaign. You know, we've been talking about that a lot just recently, that we feel like there've been a lack of story-driven games just recently. So it's a welcome sort of change to have a nice story to sort of keep you coming back for more. I also found that the puzzle designs were very cleverly designed, like purposely for virtual reality. It felt very natural, and it felt satisfying to solve them as well. Like certainly in some areas where you had like intricate circuit boards where you had to use your little pincer hands to like take off like parts of the circuit and then change them around to make sort of like a bigger machine work. That was really, really cool. But also like I like the fact that it's just like set in space. You know, I'm a big sci-fi fan, and I've mentioned it before on the podcast that, you know, that I prefer sci-fi games over like fantasy games. Yeah, so like, yeah. Although
we know you're a Skyrim hater. We know that. Yeah.
Well, I was going to mention Skyrim actually, you know, like I appreciate Skyrim for what it is. And I know that a lot of people out there love it, but it's just not my bag. So to have a sci-fi game that I can really get my head into,
I got a question for you, Mike. Like, because I mean, I played the game as well, but I obviously didn't get as far as you did. And can you, like, without spoiling, say like, how scary does it get?
So yeah, I don't want to spoil anything, but yeah, it does get a bit spooky because there's some weird stuff going on. I won't go any further than that.
All right.
But like we mentioned it on last week's show as well, that they've added smooth locomotion to the game. And yeah. I actually said last week that actually I don't mind, you know, I don't mind like a space jump, because if it's part of like the story narrative, you're in space after all. And it actually turned out that when I played the game, I turned smooth locomotion on and I ended up using that more than anything else. So
it's the best combination ever. Yeah. Having that jetpack and then also have smooth locomotion.
Yeah.
It's great.
So no. I completely redact what I said last week's show. I ended up playing it more smooth locomotion and then using the sort of jetpack boost for sections where it was required, where you had to jump over gaps, for example.
Yeah.
But yeah, I preferred it actually smooth locomotion. But yeah, it's one of those games that once I'd finished my little playthrough, I haven't finished it yet, but it's one of those games that I've been thinking about a lot since I played it. You know, I really sort of keep on getting that urge to go back and finish the game. Like, it's got that pull to it.
The gameplay mechanics in Red Matter are so freaking satisfying. The fact that you need to pull things, but really pull like you do in real life and turn things in a way where you really almost like feel like things are rusty, or where it's like, oh, I really need to
resistance. You know?
Yeah.
The resistance is like present there, and that's super nice. And yeah, as you said, the graphics are cool. And for the people that don't like scary games, I mean, I haven't played the entire game yet. I'm usually also a guy who doesn't like to play spooky, scary stuff, but it's not that bad, okay? Yeah, I mean, you have cheap jump scares and you have ones that kind of freak you out or make it more scary than it maybe is. It's like the atmosphere is more creepy than
exactly.
You know what I mean?
It's So I haven't experienced any jump scares.
You're not getting, as far as I know, you're not getting chased by crazy monsters stuff like that. It's not like Amnesia where you need to hide all the time because there's something walking around. No, it's more like, hey, just it's a part of the storyline. It's almost like scripted moments where it kind of gets tense.
Yeah, you feel very isolated, you know, because you're on this like facility, you're on your own, you're kind of exploring, trying to figure out what's going on. You have to translate everything because you don't speak the language. And yeah, it's a very cool game. I'm really looking forward to going back in, checking it out. And I definitely recommend from what I've played so far that you check it out yourself.
I got a contentious question for you, Mike, on this one then for Red Matter. Because as much as I love the visuals, love the interaction, the UX, that they're nailing so many things. I'm going to ask you and Nathie both the same question, which is so far in what you've played, like, where do you put it on the range of fun as opposed to experience?
I find it really fun because I like puzzle games and I like story-driven narrative games and I like sci-fi games. So for me, it's like a great mix. But it depends. Like, if puzzle games aren't your bag because it's got some real hardcore puzzle elements to it, then maybe you're not going to enjoy it so much. And it's not like an action game where you've got a lot of shooting or there's a lot of stuff going on. It's kind of that you've got to invest... You've got to investigate and that kind of thing. Yeah.
Has anyone already tried it on the Vive, by the way?
No. Like, I wanted to try that, but since you're using Oculus Touch controllers in this game, it's just
the thing, yeah.
You know, if usually you just have hands but this one, I mean, I think it could work. If you don't have a Rift, then you still want to play this game. So I'm sure it could work in a way. It's just that if you look at your hands, they don't match with the ones you're holding.
Mm-hmm. That's a shame.
But for me, like personally, this game gave me a little bit of a Alien Isolation vibe, but then without the alien, basically.
Yeah.
Because it's quite isolated, right? There's like quite a. It's very quite slow paced. The puzzles, I say, are a halfway step towards abduction in that they're intelligent puzzles. They don't hold your hand. The reason I giggled earlier, Mike, is because there's a puzzle in one part where you're assembling a circuit board. And I did it all in the pitch dark because I hadn't figured out to flick two switches to turn the lights on.
Yeah. And it took me a while to figure that one out as well. Like, I didn't realize there was a trick to that one.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. No, but it's on the subject of space adventures. Go on.
I asked the chat as well what they were playing this week. I've seen a lot of like Archangel Hellfire. I've seen End Space, Virtual Reality. There's a few games we were last time. Like Granada.
I'm really glad that a lot of people are playing like Virtual Reality. Yeah, so this is like a really great title. So if you own an Oculus Go, you owe it to yourself to go and play that game. But whilst on the subject of space adventures, I also went and saw the new Star Wars movie this week, Solo. And I won't give away any spoilers, but I have to say I was actually really impressed with the movie. Like, I think I was on a bit of a downer after the Last Jedi, and I was a bit disappointed with it. So I went into Solo with like pretty low expectations, but I walked away from the cinema really satisfied. So that's all I'll say about it.
It's funny though that the guy who plays how is he called again? Like Lando. He's the one that also did the This Is America video clip.
Yeah, of course.
Looking at it from that perspective is kind of strange, but
Donald Glover.
I love the idea of having like more side stories and having something more like new, because we're so used to all the characters from Star Wars, and then we get like you kind of need to get used to it, but when it works, it's so nice because then you got another future in front of you with new characters and so much. So I don't know, I can fanboy about Star Wars here, but this is a VR podcast, right?
We also have JD Max saying, speaking of space games, I saw Deadpool 2.
I really want to see that as well. There's so much out as well, like Infinity War. I still haven't seen that either, so another movie I want to check out. But let's go back to on topic with some virtual reality news and start with some sort of like quick news this week. So first up is Budget Cuts. That is launching this week. So the hotly anticipated game from Neat Corporation, it's been sort of baking in the oven for some time now. Well, in fact, since like the Vive originally released, it's been baking. So hopefully, a bit like a, you know, like a fine wine, it's sort of matured and has become something that's going to be quite tasty. Like, let's keep our fingers and toes crossed for that one. I still haven't actually played the demo myself, so I'm sort of looking forward to just going into the game completely blind and just sort of seeing what it's all about. But from what I understand of the premise, you sort of the sort of building that you're in has been taken over by evil robots. You've kind of got to escape, and you've got to use stealth and knives to take out these sort of evil sentient beings that are trying to kill you. But I also really like the look of the sort of the teleportation mechanic, because you guys have all played the demo, right? You sort of understand how that works, because it kind of is like a bit of like a portal teleportation, right? So it looks very interesting. But like I say, it's been in development for some time, so it'll be really interesting to see how it turns out when it finally comes out. And that is on Thursday, which is the 31st of May. And you can check it out on the Oculus Rift and HTC Vive on Steam.
To describe that, I'd just say it feels a lot like the like those kind of spy films where like someone's doing something in a drawer, someone opens the door, and then they just like turn around and throw a pen and get it right in their jugular. You know, like that's how it is like throughout the action sequences of that game.
So. Except for when I do it, like it like misses the subject, like
yeah,
like, and I need to like throw like four or five of them before I get it.
Such a panic.
So are they like limited? Do you have to like pick them up and collect the knives?
Yeah, you need to collect
them. Oh, they are. Okay, that's interesting.
And when I played the demo, there was a lot of stuff like, because I threw so many knives, I never picked them up again. Like,
oh, right. So you got to scoop them all up afterwards.
Yeah.
I think that the sense of being in tiny rooms, big rooms, and ceilings and things like that are so nice in Budget Cuts.
What they do so well, and I remember that from the demo, is... that you have like you need to go into a ceiling, but you need to duck physically as well.
Yeah,
because if you stand up, you can't see anything. And so you also need to do it when you throw the portal. You need to duck before you like open the portal or you go through. It's smart. Really well done. Like
hide in like the trash can and then just grab that robot and just drag him into the trash can and just hide and kill him while you're in the trash can.
Yeah. So I'm really looking forward to checking that one out. Yeah. So if you're interested in Budget Cuts, like I say, it comes out on Thursday, the 31st of May on Steam. So let's move on to our second bit of quick news, and that is the Ossic X headphones. Now, I don't know if you guys are aware of this one, but
yes. This
was a Kickstarter and Indiegogo campaign, and it was dubbed as the world's first 3D audio headphone that instantly calibrates to the listener's sort of head. And they basically stated that they could deliver incredibly accurate 3D sound by using sort of 3D audio algorithms and head tracking. And they said that it's going to be great for like music, games, movies, and of course, virtual reality. So a lot of people bought into these because they were like virtual reality enthusiasts and wanted to sort of step up their audio game, because you could put these headphones on and then sort of be more aware sort of positionally around you where sort of footsteps were coming from or where items were coming from in game. So these things weren't cheap. They were like $219 starting off at the very sort of early bird model, which was like a limited supply of. Then you could move on to sort of $249, which was again a limited run. And then finally the sort of basic price was $279. So they were pretty expensive headphones, but they had a lot of technology behind them that looked very interesting. Yeah. They were due for release around January and February last year, 2017. And the campaign was like wildly successful. Like they had sort of over 10,000 backers on Kickstarter, funded like $2.7 million in total from Kickstarter alone. Then they had another sort of $3.2 million from Indiegogo, so $6 million from crowdfunding alone. And then on top of that, they had a huge investment of another $6 million roughly. So they had around sort of $12 million to play with. And then just last week, they basically said, "We're very sorry, we've spent all the money. You're not getting your headphones," basically. So this is one of those things. It's really disappointing to see something like this happen, because we've seen some amazing Kickstarter campaigns for virtual reality. Like the Oculus Rift was originally a Kickstarter campaign that was very successful. And look where we are now, with Oculus being the sort of huge company that is obviously owned by Facebook now.
Let's not forget that Kickstarter also didn't go really as planned, right? You know, they got bought by Facebook before actually the Kickstarter was over.
Yeah, and also there was a lot of delays as well, of course. But it's just disappointing when these things happen, because it puts people off in future maybe investing in these kind of things. And some of these things normally are moving technology in huge jumps, whereas, you know, big corporations like Sony and everyone else are doing little iterations to get the most money out of their product line. Whereas these companies are saying, like, no, we want to use the best technology right now and bring something that's revolutionary out right now. Yeah. So I'm a bit disappointed, because obviously a lot of people were left, you know, spending money on something they never received. And that's always the risk with Kickstarter. You're just backing an idea. You're backing a project. You're not actually buying a product like you would in a shop. But yeah, unfortunately, they took everyone's money. They shipped like a handful of them out, but not everyone's going to get them. They basically said that we've ran out of money. Creating additional headsets requires more capital. We reached out to get some more funding, but that just isn't going to happen. And they basically just said, look, we can't deliver. We're really sorry. The Kickstarter people basically said that under the contract, if a creator can't complete their project, then there are steps that they must follow to try and obligate their, their backers to the fullest extent possible. But if they try their hardest and they run out of money, then there's nothing they can do either. So
the thing with Kickstarter is still, and I've said this already a couple of times on the show, is you're not buying a product, you know,
exactly.
You're buying basically a surface that says like, I'm going to ask a company to make that product. You're not buying a physical product. Yeah. And yes, a company can promise you to give you that product, but then the obligations for a company like that are very, very different compared to when you physically buy something in a shop or an online web store or whatever.
Absolutely.
It's a very, and I often have with like, because I do like support Kickstarter for like, you know, novel ideas and that kind of stuff. But sometimes I think that the projects that are on there are far too ambitious for like being on Kickstarter. Because if it really is something that is worth, you know, such a large budget or such a large prize or such a, it's targeting such a large market, then if there's no bigger players like Sony, like Audio Technica, whatever, that are very invested in this kind of technology, are not working on this, there's already something wrong.
That the means problem that is,
the market is not interested, or like, because I've always thought with those 3D Ossic headphones there, there's a lot of software that can do this already on a very, very high scale. And what you need for this kind of stuff is good audio input, and the headphones itself will always matter less for that kind of stuff.
Yeah. When I saw the videos doing a lot of research for the show, it seemed disappointing because it looked like very interesting technology, and it looks like it would add to the immersion, like especially in virtual reality, if you could pinpoint really accurately where something was coming from.
But you can actually, like, if you have very good audio, you can do that already. The audio source that is recorded, if that is like binaurally recorded with like you have special microphones that can do that as well. There are very nice clips of that on YouTube. For example, the barbershop is a very famous one where your hair is being cut. And literally, like, the hairs on your neck will go and stand up. Like, if you're just using regular headphones, your hairs will go and stand up. You can exactly tell where the scissor is just because of the sound. And that's because it's recorded with a binaural microphone. So in audio, there's, like, a saying to say, like, a shit in, shit out. You know, if there's, like, crap that you have and you're going to have really expensive equipment, it will still sound like crap. You know, you need to first have that really good audio quality, and then you will get.
And that's design, actually. Those parameters are design. So if you don't have studios actually backing, not just having the equipment, but also the knowledge and know-how to deliver to their audience, and VR is still in a smaller place. There's some of the bigger titles that have had, you know, DTS optimization and stuff in their games, but these are titles that are selling millions of copies. You know, VR doesn't really attract that today. Being an audiophile, I want to ask you guys one question, because I've noticed Oculus really support this area very well with the Rift and the Go. Both of those, to me, I was impressed at what they have. Like the onboard audio on the Rift, the onboard audio on the Go. I'm like, that to me is great because those are not just entry products for VR. They're also entry products for getting people into caring about sound. And that's what I was worried about with this headset. And even though the backers showed great support, selling audio is tough. So oftentimes you have to go into a store and listen to a pair of headsets to understand the difference.
I mean we heard the story of Mike like buying those JBL
ones,
you know.
So, I'm personally not a big fan of the Oculus Rift, but that's because the headphones that they're using are on ears, and I never really like that. Yeah. I'm a much bigger fan of the Oculus Go audio, actually. Like, you know, no headphones at all, just like, you know,
incredible.
Speakers built in. Well, so the amount of quality you get for that kind of technology is insane.
But then also the games they offer and experiences on Oculus Go, like most of them or a lot of them have been like well optimized as well. So like if the developer knows how to play with audio too, then it's like very like important. virtual reality. You know, that's one of those examples where it sounds so nice.
Good. Yeah, I think the thing with the Ossic is that, you know, they had this positional head tracking built into the headset itself, and also that when you actually put the headset on and stretch it out, it uses an algorithm to measure like the distance it stretched to sort of accommodate to different users' head shapes and sizes as well. So it used a lot of interesting technology, and a lot of people like from the industry, like THX, really sort of said that the technology was a great advancement and worthwhile. And I think that's why a lot of people are upset as well, that not only have they lost their money, but we're not going to get this product that had this potential, you know?
Where did they spend all this money on then?
Who knows?
That's the thing, if you have a product like this, because so much money, it goes into R&D. And I mean, you can think that that is a lot of money, but in R&D, a couple of million is literally nothing. Like, you know, in the lab where we work, which is like a very small lab, they spend millions a year just developing new technologies. R&D is insanely pricey. Insanely pricey.
True. True.
But they asked for a certain amount of money, so they knew where they were wanted to go. So if you then don't know how to spend the money wisely or in the right, then
but that's why I'm saying, like, you know, if it's not a big company that's behind this, that's a very good reason why they're not. They're thinking, first of all, the R&D money that we need to put in this is going to be far too much. And second off, maybe the target market is not going to be interested in this because the headsets are going to be too expensive, or the audio quality is not going to be that much of an improvement. It is an improvement. I'm not doubting that. But at the same time,
But we have seen this stuff before, and it's easy to get sucked into these kind of marketing things on Kickstarter, like I did as well with the sunglasses with the bone conductive headphones in. You know, you watch these reaction videos of people going, "Oh my God, this is amazing! This is like next level audio. Like I've never seen anything or heard anything like this in my life." You sort of quickly get like sucked into the whole like hype of it all. Yeah. You know,
like
the rocket. That's normal.
Like the rocket shoes I backed.
Oh, you did?
No, I'm trolling you again here, but no, I didn't. But it's still like one of the best examples, like the rocket shoes, you know.
The best thing about that
rocket shoes.
The best thing about that campaign was that you didn't actually get the rocket shoes. You got a survival kit, and you were just backing the idea. It was the craziest thing I've ever heard.
Did it ever make it? By the way,
I don't think it did.
We should have some.
We should.
I was gonna make one final point there, Mike. Just hinging on that. So. You know, in terms of this arena, like one of the things that I've noticed very much with the Go is that the Go is like I am such a fan of the Go, but I've got an IPD in the center, you know what I mean? And I've had a kind of somebody who's kind of part of our show who's big into VR and all that kind of stuff, terribly disappointed with it because his IPD is right the way out. Like, you know, he's quite I don't know if it's wall-eyed or spaced widely, but the Go totally failed him. He can't use it. It's literally too blurry for even use. And it's something that I want to mention about the audio is that not just like what we've got with VR headsets and having differences with the lenses. Like my wife looks at the Go and says she sees God rays. I can't see any. Like, and the sweet spot for me is beautiful in the Go. So same thing is true for headphones. And that's why I said, like, winding back 10 years, one of the big things I love to do was go into shops and take 20 headsets and literally spend 3 hours just listening to the audio, you know, across these different headsets, because like the one that you like is going to be so different, and audio's that way, you know? So it's just, it's a really interesting thing, but I still find the need for brick and mortar shops for that kind of technology.
Yeah, it's a very personal thing, isn't it? It is a very personal thing. You're right. Because everyone's head and ears and everything is different. Yeah. So one headset also might sound better to you than another one.
It also depends what kind of color you like of the sound. Huh? If you like a very bassy sound or like a very natural, very clean, very flat, you know, there's so many.
I thought you were going to say it all depends on what color you like. You know, you can have black ones, blue ones, red ones.
More important. It also adds up to the quality. You know, if you got those fancy gaming headsets, then you're like, well, this must be the most overpowered headset ever. And then it's just they just pump some bass in there, like a lot of bass, because that's what people want. So but it's true. I mean, Tim is totally right. It's even like when I buy myself like new parts for my computer, if there's a new sound card in there, it's like, how does it, like, it's so weird, like everything changes a lot every time you buy a new pair of headphones. It's like, hey, but this one is it's worse, but then you start listening to it more, you give it a chance, and then it gets better. And it's a little different.
Something people need to know. If you're into audio, there is a thing called burn-in for headphones. It's about 100 hours. So when you buy a new pair of headphones, to get them actually operating properly and getting the resonance properly out of the speakers in the headset, you need to burn them in. So oftentimes the recommendation is take an MP3 player or something, connect it up, and just leave it there playing away for about the first 100 hours, just a couple of days. If you don't do that and you pick up the headset, a lot of like high-end headphones, you'll listen to them and be like, this is really disappointing. So just bear in mind, that's a requirement if you buy high-end headphones.
A funny thing as well, like back in my studio days, with a lot of like big and small studios, actually, this was, they bought like a pair of really, really crappy, not headphones, like just boxes, audio boxes, like really, really bad one. And they would mix almost the entire playset on those two little mix boxes, just not even a 2.1, but like actually a 2.0 kind of setup.
Yeah.
And they did that just to get, like, if the audio is good on those, then we can make sure that it's good on, like, you know, the thousands of euros really and dollars smart. That we have set here. So they always mix on those 2.0, which is insanely funny to see, because you see so much equipment of like thousands and thousands of dollars there, and then they're mixing on like those like two little speakers just to make sure that the audio sounds good on there. that's how they know, okay, awesome. Now it's good.
That's nuts. Yeah. That's nuts. So moving on from audio to a little hedgehog. So yesterday, John Carmack from Oculus announced on Twitter that a re-release of Henry will be coming to the Oculus Go. Now, for those of you that have never met Henry before, he's a little hedgehog that lives in a little house, and it's his birthday, and he's very upset because no one came to his birthday. But it was a really sweet time, and charming little story.
There was a little hedgehog,
and it was narrated by Elijah Wood as well. And it was sort of way back in sort of DK2 days that came out, right, Nathie?
No, it's like it came with like the celebration of Oculus Home as a platform. It was like a free experience,
right. So this new version of Henry will use a new playback technology on the Oculus Go, which will allow 5K by 5K resolution at 60 frames per second to be played in the Oculus Go. So because the Oculus Go has slightly improved optics over the Rift, this could be really cool indeed. And it could be like the sort of go-to application to show off the Oculus Go's capabilities to sort of friends and family. And John Carmack says that this new technique will set the bar for immersive video quality in virtual reality. So it's very exciting indeed. He did explain how all this sort of wizardry is done. So bear with me when I read this out, because it didn't make any sense to me.
Yeah.
But he said in a tweet, basically, I love this. It just starts off like basically, it makes 2K by 2K baseline, then extracts the core 5K by 2K section, 1K from each eye, then cuts it into 10 segments, of which only 3 plus the baseline are decoded at one time. VSync locked frame release plus low latency fast path audio 360 spatialization. I'm like, seriously, dude, you're like talking in like a robot language. Like this
So all these numbers means Henry and Oculus Go.
Yeah.
At 60
total sense
seconds.
To me, Mike. I mean, I got it.
I don't know what you're making a problem of.
Yeah, man. Yeah, no problem. No problem.
What he's basically saying is, it's going to look really nice on the Oculus Go.
but I have to say, though, I kind of always, the thing is, I mean, I respect him by all means, but when he was talking about like mobile VR headsets, I was always like, yeah, whatever, like, you know, mobile VR, this and that, and I don't really care. But when they came out with the Oculus Go, I kind of like, you know, he kind of like rose even more in like the things that he's doing now. So, I mean, if he's saying that this is impressive, then it probably is going to be impressive.
Yeah,
and if he says it would change the market, it will probably change the market. I'm giving him the benefit of the doubt.
But still, I'm happy someone is working on the 360 stuff, because I watched way too many pixelated things that I had to stream or download. And I watched more disappointing 360s than
60 experiences that you watch.
Well, yeah. I mean, you can ask Zim. I mean, Zim did some testing on that. So if you really want to know more about
that. Always the unicorn videos. Yes, all the unicorn
videos. Yeah, the unicorn ones. No, but if you want to see an impressive 360 on the go right now, download the Disney Movies app. You got some really high quality 360s there. So if you are looking for some cool Disney adventures, then that's the one.
Yeah. Also, whilst on the subject of good 360 experiences, if you haven't tried it, I would also recommend the best one that I've ever tried was the Lego Batman one. If you've ever seen the Lego Batman movie, it is hilarious.
Yeah.
It's so, so funny. You can actually jump in the Lego Batmobile and he's literally sitting right next to you. It is so funny.
And the one liked a while back was Coco, the kind of primer for that. That was good on the Rift, but also I tried the Go version and I was really surprised they actually managed to downsample that. And even with the interactivity at the start where you're like, you're a skeleton, you're putting on different outfits, they actually translated it. Like it's a fair offering. It doesn't step too far away from the original experience. So So the Coco VR is another good one.
So John Carmack said that this will be coming soon to the Oculus Go as a native application. It's likely to be free, but he did warn, obviously, because of the resolution and everything and the magic that they've used on this product, that the download will be pretty big, but we don't know any more details.
And like, how does that work in like power? Because will it also like use more power to do this or not? Is that not really...
No, I don't think so. It'll probably be intensive for the CPU and that of the Go, so it might get a bit warm, like in intensive applications. But other than that, I think it'll be fine.
The one thing I have to comment from Reddit, I saw a great quote. Someone said, "I count myself as an atheist insofar as unless we're allowed to count John Carmack as a god."
The guy is a genius. Like, he's up there, like, he used to sort of interact with Steve Jobs when it came to sort of like iOS design and stuff like that. So the dude is legit. So like Nathie says, if he says something's impressive, likely going to be very impressive.
The guy single-handedly changed PC gaming. I'm sure that he knows what he's doing.
Yeah, that's right.
You guys are talking technology. All I fucking care about is Doom.
Well, let's see if this next topic will be on par with Doom then, to sort of whet your appetite then, Zim, because we're going to be talking about Rec Room Battle Royale. So the Rec Room developers Against Gravity are at it again, and they're coming up with another awesome update to Rec Room. If you've been living under a rock and you don't know what Rec Room is, it's basically a must-have free application for Oculus Rift, HTC Vive, and PSVR. And it's basically an application where you can sort of gather, socialize, hang out, and play sort of games cross-platform with your friends. You know, it's a great one for cross-platform play, right? So you can play with PSVR owners if you're in a Rift or a Vive or whatever. It just works, and it works really well. So previously, Rec Room has brought you some awesome quests like Rise of the Jumbotron, which was like a kind of sci-fi laser quest kind of quest. And then they brought out recently Isle of the Lost Skulls, which is kind of a pirate-themed one, which me, Rowdy, and Zim jumped into. And oh man, we had a lot of fun playing that one, but we were just so bad at it that we didn't complete
you,
it.
You.
Wow, I'm pretty sure me and Zim were carrying you a lot of the time, Rowdy. I didn't want to mention it on the show, but you know, now that you've brought it up. But Rec Room, obviously, being on the huge success of, like, you know, PUBG and Fortnite and Battle Royale games are, like, super popular right now. Like, they're big news, and they're bringing in big bucks for these companies. So it's a great opportunity for them to dip their toe into the sort of arena. And before the show, I thought I'd go and check it out for myself. So if you're familiar with sort of Battle Royale games, you tend to start in like a plane or a helicopter or a blimp or something. In Rec Room, you start off on a cable car. So with 16 players in total, and you're all on the cable car together. You can talk and chat to each other. And then the cable car doors open and you basically jump out on a glider down to Frontier Island, which is like this sort of map. And you're all sort of wearing backpacks, so you've got, like, you can just reach behind your backpack, pull out the map, and that'll show you your location on the map. And then that's really important because there's a swarm of bees, which are closing in, which closes over time to sort of force players to sort of all meet up in a central point. But yeah, you know, once you've sort of jumped out and you land, like every sort of Battle Royale game, you don't have anything. So you've got to search and scavenge for your weapons and items. So there's a big sort of dash to get to the boxes to open them and then find your weapons. And then you sort of can sort of start fighting with other players. But yeah, I had a lot of fun with it. I was playing for around an hour. And because I don't play Rec Room that often, like the last time I played was probably with you guys. Like, I'm a real noob when it comes to the shooting ones. So I didn't even know how to reload my gun. So I was just like unloading, like, yeah, I'm like, oh, I don't even know how to reload now. So I died like so many times before I actually got to grip with the mechanics of it.
Big mechanic question for you, Mike, because I saw it in the video.
Yeah, sure.
Is it teleport or is it smooth?
Ah, that's a great question, actually.
What they did.
Yeah. Very good question. At the very beginning, before you get into the game, they say, do you want to play teleport or do you want to play smooth locomotion? And depending on your choice, you'll only be playing with players that choose the same locomotion method as you do.
God.
Yeah.
Yeah, because otherwise it wouldn't have been fair.
Because you have always people that are complaining then when you're playing teleport. You've always people complaining when you're playing locomotion. But by just separating that, and they have the player base to do this.
Yeah.
There's a lot of people that are playing Rec Room. Let's not forget, it's a free game, which is awesome. I mean, if there's one game that I would recommend to every VR player, then it is that one.
Uh-huh.
The social, the What?
Recommend.
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 I wasn't following. I was like,
computing.
But yeah, I mean, the mini games in there are so much fun, and now this is being added as well, and it's still free. It's mind blowing.
It still amazes me, like, how they do this for free. But I think we mentioned in a previous show that eventually they're gonna have in-game items that you can buy.
Yeah, they already like advanced with the progression system where you can buy items now, as far as I know. So I'm sure like the cosmetics thing is gonna be the. Yeah. I don't know. Maybe they're just gonna do Rec Room 2 later on. I don't know.
Yeah. It's so smart.
Like, the updates are so nice. Like.
Yeah.
Game just it's how long has it been like existing already, like 2 years?
Yeah
that's impressive, and still having a player base, man, like, wow.
And they update the game like every week, like, seriously, they chuck an update out all the time. But it was funny because, like, I actually, after I sort of played it a bit and got used to the mechanics and the reloading, which is obviously important, I actually managed to get to number two, spot with 5 kills. And I was like, I was actually like buzzing afterwards. And it's been a while because I don't really play competitive multiplayer games much. But you know when you sort of like really get into like multiplayer games and you get like really like that adrenaline boost when you're sort of like, you know, think you're going to win a game? Obviously, I didn't, but, you know, I was close enough to get my sort of heart racing a little bit. So kind of got that buzz off it a little bit that I really sort of want to go back and play some more now.
Awesome. That's a really good sign. People are saying in the chat, so that the only downside is that people are currently teaming up, and with only 16 players in a map, single players have almost no chance to win.
I was just about to mention the same thing, because I was going to ask, are we going to be able to play together? Because if so, then that's a loophole.
Yeah, party system.
Well, the issue at the moment, like, unless it's 4v4v4v4, then it's pretty unfair.
Yeah, so people can team up, and a lot of people were having those sort of team up pre-chats before like jumping out of the cable car. But like, I came across like a couple of two players like playing together. Obviously, there's a lot of kids playing, so, you know, I just slotted those noobs. so, you know, if
Mike,
you're good, like,
I was gonna say, Deer Hunter's gonna be great for you. All right.
Yeah, get some practice in. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but like, how can you really like. You can't really do much about that, as far as I know.
No.
Like, I played a couple of rounds in Fortnite, but as far as I know, if you do a solo there, then you can't even make a party in the first place.
No,
so, but since there are rooms there, you can just say like, "Hey, join this room." If it's just throwing you into a random room, that would be a lot better.
Yeah, but you could, for example, just agree with each other. If you see me, like, we're gonna meet there. We're not gonna kill each other. Yeah, you can always do that. Huh?
It's an immediate problem. It's a game design issue, because on one side, Rec Room, we all know, it's a meet your friends, play with your buddies, you know, it's a hangout with people game. And that's the social glue. Whereas Battle Royale is kind of the opposite to an extent.
It's funny because I landed at one point and this guy was near me and I picked up a sniper rifle and I was like aiming at his head. And he was like, dude, don't kill me. Let's just team up for a bit. And I was like, yeah, sure, let's go. So like I said, oh, there's a loot box over here. So he opened it and pulled out a grenade and just dropped it on the floor and killed us both. I'm like, dude, seriously.
Yeah, that's also something I'm afraid of, since Rec Room has a lot of kids on there. Yeah. The level of seriousness or the way you kind of want to play it is not really going to happen there. But, like, if you know what I mean?
But we have an advantage because these kids, they were just screaming their heads off like the whole time. You can hear them like a mile away. So I was just like sneaking up on them.
Yeah,
you scream as much as you want, little Timmy. You're about to get captured.
Mike the Creep in action. Mike the
Creep. Like, I think I saw Mike today in Rec Room in Battle Royale, and he was like taking like one kid hostage. He was like, yeah, he's gonna die if you don't give me this loot box. You know, you want to trade? You want to have this little Oompa Loompa?
Yeah, I already see him.
I'm gonna be playing some more tonight.
Mike is like shh, and then he's like just like Splinter Cell, you know, like
dropping from a tree.
I like how you all go super gangsta when it's talking about slaughtering kids. Drop you guys in the Bronx. Let's see how well you fare. That's all I'm saying.
JD Max the Game Cat says that they're working on it right now, but it's a bit crazy.
Yeah, it is. Like, this is the thing. Like, this weekend is just a test. Like, the full thing isn't actually released yet. It started yesterday, Friday the 24th, and will run until tomorrow, Sunday the 27th. And you can check it out for free, obviously. But then they'll release it as a full feature in the future. But I'd urge you to check it out because it is a lot of fun. The only thing that frustrated me was that they've got a mechanic where you can attach things to your belt. And that didn't really work so well. So you can attach a potion or a spare gun. But yeah, that sort of was really sort of hit and miss. And a lot of the time it just dropped to the floor.
Potion? Well, what kind of potions you mean?
You can have a health potion, which is green. Or you can have a blue potion, which boosts your overall sort of HP.
Yeah. Oh, and how can you see that? Do you have like a HUD or something? Or
yeah, you have a small HUD at the bottom, which represents your health. And then you can see how many players are left. And then also on the right, you've then got your ammunition for your gun, how many bullets you got left. Okay. Yeah, it's a ton of fun. So yeah, if you're interested, you can check that out. But like I say, check it out this weekend, because otherwise you're going to be waiting a little while. So next up, we're going to be talking about the Forest VR. And like Zim mentioned at the very beginning of the show, it was one of those games that kind of originally launched in early access on Steam about sort of 4 years ago now. So it's relatively old in terms of games, but it's just come out of early access now. So it's like a fully fledged game now, a bit like Subnautica, you know, that, and I'm sure there'll be some comparisons between the two games as well. Mm-hmm. But the developers, Endnight Games, they've been updating the title ever since, obviously, it came out. And they've always been talking about sort of a VR release of the game. But that didn't come out, obviously, until they finally released it out of early access last week. But if you're not familiar with the premise of The Forest, it's sort of fairly simple in that you start off on a plane. You have this kind of epic plane crash that you're actually a part of. In VR, which is pretty terrifying in itself. I'm not a fan of flying, so it'll be interesting to check this one out. But then you land on this kind of mysterious forest area that's inhabited by some strange cannibal creatures that want to sort of eat you up and mess you up. And you've got to like learn how to sort of build a shelter and scavenge wood and food and items and to survive and basically stay alive. But I've never actually played the game, but you've had time to check it out, right, Zim? You've had some sort of hands-on time with the game.
Yeah, I think one of the things that people... Well, there's a few things to mention, right? First off, if you have The Forest originally from 2D days, this is a free patch. So that's a cool thing. Second thing is, if you're like disappointed that at the moment multiplayer isn't an option because the game normally supports multiplayer, building bases, etc. Again, that's coming. But also there is a trick to this at the moment. If you get one player who is a kind of a flat gamer, a 2D gamer, they can invite VR friends, and actually you can do a multiplayer game that way. So that's a cool trick that, you know, Reddit taught me. I haven't used it yet, I'm afraid. So that's something that I think is, if you're interested in gaming with friends, and you both, as I said, have, or several of you have The Forest, then definitely check that out. In terms of the game, I would say it reminded me first and most heavily of Ark. Survival Evolved, mm-hmm. back in when it had VR support. And that's not to say that the quality was that level. No, the quality is far much better. I could tell Nathie was already about to jump on that.
Yeah, you're brave comparing like Ark Survival Evolved with like
calling Ark a VR game even.
Well. So it had some chance, but it never, ever transpired, and it was awful quality. This is not bad. It's totally playable. I was a bit nervous because I was seeing reports of bugs, and yes, there are bugs in the game. One of the things that I didn't realize, and I don't think this is a spoiler, the plane when it crash lands does not always crash land in the same place. So your surroundings are different. You could almost call it procedural, but really it's kind of like almost like a battle royale game.
Yeah.
It's just
a different location on the map.
And the cool thing is that as you're surviving, Mike, you compared this to Subnautica. I'd also say the Solus Project. So these games require you to survive, and there's an element of keeping yourself, you know, not hungry, not too cold, all those kinds of things. And they're here as well. What I would say is that as a survival game, the crafting system is probably the least annoying crafting system that I've seen in VR. Whereby you have like a book of recipes, and the recipe book is very easy to interact with. And when you are collecting materials, like the logs you see on the shoulder in the video that we're running at the moment, when you're carrying materials back to your base or whatever, actually what you see is like this ghosted object, and you can just collect pieces, bring them back, and kind of like add bits on, like sticking bits on. So until you've completed it, you can't use it, but you can still kind of see its ghost shape there, which means you can either have literally a ghost town of stuff you haven't managed to build yet, or you can kind of pace yourself and build building by building. But I found there were all these different types of things. Like there was a water collector, which you have to murder some tortoises, get their shell, get that inverted on a couple of stakes, and then that'll collect water if and when it rains. You know, there's a whole host of different things. And I did find that the crafting system was the main thing that stood out. And like Sayub, which is like a Minecraft-esque VR game, it has a tree felling system whereby you have to actually go around the base of a tree trunk, axing away, chopping wood away, and there's like wood chips flying.
That's awesome.
And even massive tree trunks, like they fall like with this lovely picturesque kind of toppling over.
So wait. So if I play like soon a multiplayer with, let's say, Rowdy or you or Mike, I can just crush someone with a tree.
Because I'm on my first playthrough, like, I haven't yet.
Dropping, sorry.
Timber!
<Oops. laughs> All I had myself do, and Mike, I have to say throughout the whole thing was, I was singing, I'm a lumberjack and I'm okay. You know, like the whole time I'm just swinging away. So.
Yeah, do they have like a duo saw as well where you can just do it with like together? Can you do that?
We could do that. Well, let's make a video, Nathie. Let's do that. But I think I'd say overall, Subnautica is way more polished. Late game, Subnautica has some really annoying bugs in VR at the moment. But Subnautica is probably the game that I would probably recommend out of all the survival games that I've played. Project feels a little bit more isolated, as in there's a lot less happening, less interaction. The forest, you mentioned the creepy things. There's tribes around, and they do not hold back. This is definitely a mature game. You will see stuff that you don't really want to see. I think Rowdy saw me and the stewardess, but anyway, let's just forget that happened. You end up with bloodied hands a lot of the time, and you can chop the heads off of everything, from a shark to a bird. I mean, this game is not a faint of heart kind of game, and the things that attack you are violent. So that's where I'm going to leave it. There are bugs. There are plenty of bugs in the game, but it is totally playable.
I've seen you stream, and I have to say, like, those things, they freak me out. Like, especially because the thing that I think that the forest does so well is the audio. Like, you know, you hear audio's like something whistling in the bush, and you think like, oh, is that one of them? Is that one of them? And then all of a sudden, you hear like someone laughing. Like, they have like that kind of weird like kind of voice
that's tone weird.
That they use as well. Oh, it's, it freaks me out when they do that. But
it's like survival game, but in the meanwhile you're like in like a horror movie as well, where you're like in a forest and you have no idea what's going on, what's living there, man.
Yeah.
Rowdy just reminded me. One VR tip for our friends playing the forest. If you happen to be swimming in murky waters, don't leave your door open to have your dog's cold nose go up your trouser leg. Because I thought a shark was about to kiss my jewels. That was pretty scary.
That's brilliant. So Zim, like out of the games, like you say, of the Solus Project, Subnautica, and this, you would maybe say Subnautica has the edge in terms of like a survival crafting game in VR right now?
For now, by far. And I would say this one will battle with Solus Project. Solus Project is actually, it's good, but it's UI. It's kind of UX, it's interface. And its audio aren't quite as good as this.
Yeah.
This one, the fact that we've waited 2+ years for this game to come out, it shows that they've buffed it a bit. As I said, there's bugs, but they're forgivable.
That's the thing a little bit. Like, you know, it's also with the Forza is made by, I think, a team of four guys. I think there's only four guys working on that. And to give them some credit as well, I mean, it feels more like a VR game than Subnautica feels like a VR game. Subnautica is nice, but you can't play it with motion control. Right?
Fair
you
enough. Yes.
100%.
Right? 100%.
So, I mean, in terms of that, I do give the Forza a little bit the edge of like, okay, maybe the game itself isn't as good as Subnautica. But the VR integration, I think, is better.
And that could change for me, because I haven't played that far. I mean, there are things that happen in the game that haven't happened to me yet. So I'll report back in future weeks anyway, Mike.
Are you going to be planning to stream that one more over the coming
absolutely.
Weeks?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
So if you're interested in checking out some VR streams, you know, head over to Zim's Twitch stream. You can see him get eaten alive by cannibals in a forest.
I have to warn people, though, like, be careful if you watch with headphones, because Zim can have a very high-pitched voice. Yeah. Very high-pitched.
I've heard it firsthand. Well,
I mean, Mike was there.
When he starts,
Usually when he starts laughing in this podcast, I'm just I go back, you know, that's what I do.
So moving on from the forest then, let's talk about our final topic, and that is some Vive Focus updates. So if you're not familiar with the Vive Focus, it's a standalone headset from HTC, which provides 6 degrees of freedom in the headset, 3 degrees of freedom in the controller. Now, the headset is only available in China right now, unless you import one, and it retails for around $600. Is that right, Nathie? $600? I think that's about right.
Yeah, 600.
So at the ecosystem conference in China this week, HTC announced some updates for the Vive Focus. They simply call these updates System Updates 2.0, very imaginative. But they said that they've got some cool features coming to the Vive Focus. And the first one I want to talk about is 6 degrees of freedom controller update. Yep. Now, they just teased about this. They were very sort of light on exact information about it. But what they said was that they can make the 3 degrees of freedom controller feel more like a 6 degrees of freedom controller by utilizing the two front facing cameras to capture the movements of the player's hand and the controller. So that's really interesting. And I was like, okay, I was thinking about this. I was like, okay, so if they're going to use those cameras for that function, how will that then affect the positional tracking function? Like, can the cameras do both at the same time, or is it just going to be a case of one or the other? But like I say, we don't know what the score is with this because they were very light on details.
Sounds janky to me. Sounds like you're going to have, because if you know how it is, if you have any hand interruption, you know, and if you're getting the hand interruption even every 30 seconds or every 2 minutes, like it just becomes so like, I just don't want to use it like that.
Yeah, so that'd be very interesting. But if they can do both at the same time and actually pull this off, then it sounds really interesting indeed. Because I know, you know, we've got the Lenovo Mirage Solo, we've got the Oculus Go, we've got the Vive Focus. Mm. But with these kind of updates, it makes the Vive Focus certainly more appealing for someone like myself.
They're going to make us all buy one of those ugly Crocs, aren't they?
But like, yeah, I mean, like the Vive Focus,
is going to have to get one.
I said this before, but haven't played with it. There's no way I would pay that money over a Go. It's just not a superior headset in any way.
So let me tell you about the other updates, and maybe that will sway your mind. I'd love to know to see if your thoughts on it has changed.
Seeing as I fed you this update, Mike. Yes. Uh-huh. Go ahead.
Yeah.
What was this?
But like I say, about while I'm touching on the controller and the 6 degrees of freedom update, they're saying that developers can play around with this in the next couple of weeks and start integrating that into their games. But we're not going to see it as consumers until later on in the year. And plus, to be fair, we're not going to see it as consumers anyway, because we can't buy one just yet in the US or in the Europe. So we're going to have to wait till later on in the year to get one ourselves anyway, unless you import one, of course.
When was that coming, Mike? Do you remember?
So later on in the year, they're saying sort of Q3, Q4. Okay. So that's for that update and when you can buy it over here as well.
Good.
So the other feature that they talked about was Steam VR streaming to the Vive Focus. Now, this is very interesting. What they're saying is that you can wirelessly stream PC VR games from Steam and Viveport over a 5 gigahertz Wi-Fi connection to your Vive Focus. So that's going to be interesting, because that means that you're completely untethered. You're playing PC VR experiences on a standalone headset.
Isn't that just the Steam app that just got recently launched?
Steam
because
Link?
There's an app where you can... Yeah, the Steam Link app that is now like on your phone as well.
No, so they're using similar technology. What they're actually using is an application called Riftcat V-Ridge. I don't know if you're aware of this. But it's like an Android application, because obviously, you know, like the Oculus Go and the Lenovo Mirage, the Vive Focus uses Android as its base platform. Mm. And using this Riftcat V-Ridge software, you can stream mobile content to a mobile device that's running Android. So whether that be a mobile phone, a Google Cardboard, Oculus Go, Gear VR, whatever it may be.
I still want to see it though. Like how is the latency of something like that? Like,
of course. Well, they're saying that you're going to need a 5 gigahertz Wi-Fi network for this to work because of latency, I would imagine. And you know, it's the same sort of speed that the Intel wireless technology is going to use as well. So that's, you know, if they can get the latency right, then it'll be interesting.
5 gig is just dual band. That's the reason, Mike. Yeah, so you 2.4.
I know that single. Eric is in the chat. Maybe he has some more info on that, because I think he recently tried one as well. Maybe you know some more about like the latency and how that works with like a wireless
Yeah. I think the most interesting thing about this is, like, it's all well and good being able to stream this content straight to your headset, but it's what controllers are you going to use to interact with the game itself? Like, they're saying that the 3DOF focus controller will work, but how many games are you going to be able to use?
I'm going to play Rocket League with that. There must be some simple, like, I think, like, platform games could be fun. I think that could work.
Yeah, and they are saying as well that you can pair like a traditional gamepad, like an Xbox controller or a compatible PC controller, and play games using controller that way, because obviously your controller will be paired to your PC. The stream will just be running to your headset.
Yeah.
But it's just whether or not that they can actually take advantage of the Steam VR library to actually have some proper.
It sounds a lot like the Steam Link that sold for, it was initially like $60 and then they ended up discounting it to like $5 or something like that. And I've heard both very positive and negative reports based on home networks and how they work. So this is one of those all I read into this actually is that HTC are going, oh God, the Go is lashing us right now. What can we give people to maybe steal a little bit of the thunder? And they both sound like janky updates to me, but let's see if they pull it off.
It still sounds like they're not really planning to compete with the Go in the first place. They are not in a hurry at all. And I don't know what they want to do with the Focus exactly. It's from a different price range because it's also a different headset. It's not the same as the Go. The Go is a total, like, they are not in the same lineup as, you know, you have like the Oculus Go, you have the Oculus Rift, you have all kinds of things in between. But yeah, if you could compare it in a way, but on the other side, you can't compare it because it's much more expensive because it has more features or different features than the Go has. So it's kind of like,
what do you play on it? I mean, like, what is the attraction?
It's a developer kit. Yeah, just like when you played with the DK1 and the DK2, you're playing some nonsense maybe. In China, they do have a lot of like content already.
Okay. So I think
Eric, by the way, says that the controller works, but it only has 3 usable buttons. So there's only three buttons on it, on the controller.
Right.
And so also we have Nolo. I don't know if you guys know that. Nolo, that is something that allows like 6 degrees freedom tracking on the Gear VR.
Yeah, of course. And I think we will be talking about the Nolo in a future episode because it is a very interesting topic as well. Mm-hmm. But talking about the Vive Focus, like, it's an interesting move for them because, like you say, the Go has got this great library of games, you know, but if you can get the Vive Focus to work well with this whole library of Steam VR content, then you've got an even bigger library of content there as well. So it would be interesting to see if they could combine both the streaming feature of the Steam VR and the 6 degrees of freedom update as well. Yeah.
That's exactly the problem. This is what HTC Vive has been like suffering from the start, is like the content. If Oculus makes their own games, they had the Gear VR platform for a while, and now they have the Go and it works with the Gear VR app. So you have so much content. Well, HTC still needs to build it up. Mm-hmm. Well, Oculus had a head start, basically.
They've got a magic bullet, though. They just haven't fired it yet. Well, any Valve title on any single HTC platform.
But just a wild guess. Now we're going into the Valve section again. Let's say like Valve made a Steam machine. They made a Steam Link. What if they make, let's say, some sort of Oculus Go as well, where they say like, hey, this whole Steam Link thing, it works. We have the Steam gamepad as well. And we got a new one that works in VR too. And
it comes with Half-Life 3.
But their hardware has been rubbish. It's not taken off.
About mobile. They're not very into the mobile market.
I got all of that Valve hardware, by the way. I got the Steam controller. I absolutely love it. Like, it allows me to play first-person shooters without a mouse. I love the hardware that I got a Steam Link. I got the Steam controller. I immediately bought it as soon as it came out. And also, by the way, Nathie, your brother says that he thinks that the Vive is actually aiming for the Focus to be a competition for the Santa Cruz when it comes out.
Yeah, well, that's it. That's what I wanted to say. It's in a different lineup. That's true. Or compete with that one than with the Oculus Go.
It's not a consumer product, because I thought this is a boxed consumer product that's available in China.
It is in China, and like Nathie says, it's not a library of games in China.
There, if you want to buy one in China, you need to order one through the website by filling in your company name and all that kind of stuff. It's not like you can just walk into a store. When my brother picked one up, he was just at like some kind of warehouse, and they had to like give him one there. but it's not something you can just buy as a consumer. So it's really a developer's kit. Yeah. It could even be that the actual Vive Focus is going to look a lot different than this one. You know, I don't know. It's not a prototype. But it's more like a development.
Yeah. Eric said that another few things that they added was a passenger mode and see-through mode for 3 degrees of freedom in a vehicle to watch movies and pass through and light AR applications.
All right, Eric, do you want to be the host of the show? Like, Jesus, you're going to see all the content.
Hey, Eric, please, Mike is, please.
Yeah.
That's a question I had. Mike, you're doing more content than anyone else here. Yeah. Question. So, there's a mode in the Go it's like travel mode. What is that? Do you know?
No, I haven't seen that. Where is that?
I think it's not. Maybe it's just Netflix app or something. But there's a for when you're watching something, it's like a travel mode or a. I don't know what it does. I like turn it on, turn it off. I have no idea. If anyone in chat knows, please enlighten us.
Yeah, but like Eric's right in that, you know, there is some updates as well that add to the comfort. If you're traveling with the Vive Focus, then you can turn off the positional tracking, so it will just be 3 degrees of freedom on the headset, and then you can wear it on a plane or a train or in a car comfortably. They've also added another update which allows you to use the pass-through cameras to actually see your surroundings as well. So, you know, you don't have to take the headset off. And apparently the sort of head of HTC walked on stage with it on using that function to sort of walk up onto the stage so we could see his
surroundings. That's very cool, actually. That's very cool. Also, on the travel mode, apparently that maintains the screen in the middle of your field of view.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
That's what travel mode does.
The thing is, like, just going back quickly to the controllers and this kind of and streaming content to the Vive Focus, is that you can actually install Riftcat VRidge right now if you've got a Vive Focus, like you've imported one. It's available on Viveport, and then you can try it out for yourself and start streaming some VR content from your Steam library and check it out yourself.
So I can try it for science.
You could. You could put your mind, body, and soul on the line for us.
Yeah.
Okay. So just a couple more little updates. Seagate are partnering up with HTC to make an external battery pack that also has a storage solution built into it, which is going to attach to your belt. It's got like a little belt clip. And then you could just run a cable straight up to your headset, and you can have some extra battery life and some additional storage there as well. So that's a very interesting product. And then finally, some HTC smartphones that are compatible with the Vive Focus will enable you to get mobile updates and notifications in the Focus itself. So say if you get like a text message or a phone call, well, then you can answer that in the headset without having to take it off. But obviously it's limited to certain HTC smartphones. But that's kind of interesting. But for me, I don't know, like when I'm in VR playing games or like watching movies, certainly in the Oculus Go, I like the fact that I'm not being distracted by my mobile phone or like people around me. Do you know what I mean? Just kind of get really immersed into the movie or the game that I'm playing without the constant notifications on my phone. Because even my phone being here right now, it's a constant distraction when I get a text message or an email notification. I'm constantly looking at it.
And that's exactly the opposite of my wife. She's like, get out of the feckin' Go and pay attention to your family. No, it does happen.
Yeah. Is there like a family mode too for Zim that he can turn on, like next to the passenger mode?
Well, Zim might be interested in a function in the Oculus Go, that is, that you can actually use a pattern lock to unlock it. So if you've left it on some questionable content, then you can lock it up and no one's going to be exposed to whatever you're into. So there we have it.
Interesting.
So yeah, if you're interested in the Vive Focus, you're obviously going to be able to pick one up later on in the year. Some of these updates and stuff like this that they're working on now will probably be key features when they finally do launch it. And, you know, like you mentioned as well, there's probably a lot of developers right now that are playing around with the technology and working on some cool games for this platform. I really hope so anyway. So yeah, unless you've got any questions, I'll just quickly recap the show times and wrap this baby up. So just a reminder, obviously, it is a weekly VR, AR, and MR talk show. It's live streamed every Saturday on Nathie's YouTube channel. You can tune into the live show, which I would recommend. You can sort of interact with us, ask us questions at the show times of 7 p.m. in Europe, 6 p.m. in the UK, and 12 midday in Central US. If you missed the live stream, you can catch up with the re-upload on my own channel, Virtual Reality Oasis, or you can check out the audio version, which is available on Google Play Music, iTunes, and on SoundCloud. So...
Yeah, I got one more comment to make. I was this week actually quite impressed with the amount of content that is actually coming out. Like, we got The Forest, we got Rec Room, we got Archangel, we got Budget Cuts that is coming out next week.
Brewmaster.
Exactly.
Brewmaster. Arizona Sunshine DLC.
DLC, Rat Matter. So there's like a there's so much content that I can barely like play everything at the moment.
Literally can't keep up. Hey, I literally can't keep up.
Welcome to the club.
It's all right. You don't need to sleep, Rowdy. That's my top tip.
Okay.
Just sleep in virtual reality and you'll be fine.
Exactly.
Yeah. But yeah, you're right. And it's a great problem to have. A little while ago, we were saying that we were very sort of light on content, and now we're sort of overwhelmed by the amount of content we've got to play.
Yeah. Developers listen to us. They made a lot of content.
they're big fans of this podcast.
I think so.
Yeah,
that's true.
They worked on their games for like 5 years, and now they're like, okay, they start complaining. Now we release our game. This is the moment.
Yeah. So unless we've got any more questions, we'll wrap this one up. I hope you guys and girls have enjoyed this one as much as we have enjoyed making this one for you, because we're having a ton of fun interacting with each other, talking about VR. Obviously, we love VR. We're very passionate about it. But also, we love being able to sort of do this live and interact with you at the same time as well. Check out the Nolo we were going to say? Yeah, Nolo. We will be talking about that in a future episode for sure. And it's going to be a very interesting one, because it adds 6 degrees of freedom to like an Oculus Go or a Gear VR. So make sure you stay tuned for that one. So I hope you guys and girls have enjoyed this one, and we will see you on next week's episode. Until then, bye-bye.
Bye.